Okay, our next talk is by Becky Wiseman and Laurie McBride of Suffolk County Cornell Cooperative Extension. Becky Wiseman coordinates the Agricultural Stewardship Program for Cooperative Extension in Suffolk County on Long Island. For those of you who don't know, the county is in New York by heart. Suffolk County is the easternmost county on Long Island. For the past 11 years, she and her staff can this just, oh, okay. All right. I'm too. Oh, well. Okay. So for the past 11 years, Becky and her staff have implemented on-farm demonstration projects in cooperation with extension research educators to minimize the leaching of agrochemicals into the aquifer, the region's sole source of drinking water. Becky will talk about the Suffolk County network. Laurie McBride will talk about how they're using it. And Laurie is an agricultural stewardship technician for Cornell University Cooperative Extension of Suffolk County. She is involved in implementing stewardship practices in greenhouse, nursery, and tree fruit commodities. Currently, Laurie is coordinating the comprehensive IPM program for tree fruit growers. To date, the program regularly scouts 12 farms covering over 600 acres of tree fruit production, aiding the growers in improved pest management strategies. Becky and Lori.
Okay, good. All right, we're all set. Thank you, Becky. Thank you. Okay, just a little bit about the Ag Stewardship Program. It's run, or it's primarily was funded starting in 2004 by the Suffolk County Legislature. And the reason being is that, like Julie said, we sit on top of an aquifer that supplies all of the water for Nassau and Suffolk County. And we have a quite large agricultural industry, and all of our soils are very porous due to the glacier activity back in before we all were on Earth. And so our goal primarily is to work on farms with growers and increase and improve their pest and nutrient management practices. So just a little bit about Long Island, because I don't know how many of you have been out to the far eastern part of Long Island. Oh my God, I'm so excited. You made it through New York City and back again, and all in one piece. That's great. So a little bit about us, we're 140 square miles from tip to tip, and we have both Nassau and Suffolk County, 7.8 million people, and it's 118 miles long. Now it takes Lori and I about 2 hours to get from where we are, 2.5 hours, through New York City. So we're out on the very tip end of Long Island. Suffolk County itself, which is like just like from here on out, we are 1.5 million people and 912 square miles. So we have quite a lot of people out there on the very end. And we have now 600 farms, and we are, like we say here, we like to say that we were number one in agriculture production, but however, the milk production down out here, up here, and all of the yogurt has like sent us plummeting to number three. And so we're like, you know, sort of upset about that, but we understand. We are number one in aquaculture and number one in nursery sales. And of course, we have a very large grape production, which is primarily vinifera grapes. So we have quite a large number of wineries on the island. So just a little bit about our weather stations. We were able to receive grant funding, and so we have 18 to 20, depending on the week or the month, weather stations that stretch from almost Nassau County all the way out to, this is Orient Point, so this is the North Fork of Long Island, this is the South Fork. Most of our farms are situated right here, and the initial grant was from, the initial grant that we had was from a the Long Island Sound Futures Fund. So this is the Long Island Sound. So all of our grants at that particular time were at wineries situated right along the coast of the Long Island Sound. Then when we were able to get Ag and Markets grants, and we were, that was for the tree fruit program. So that gave us a little more leeway, and so we were able to then sort of stretch our weather stations to all the way on to the South Fork to this is Watermill. Why did we get these grant fundings? Why did we purchase all of these weather stations on, you know, on this really short little bit of land? When you think about it, it's only like, what, 23 miles wide. We're surrounded by water. We have a lot of microclimates. And one of the most interesting things about this was there are two weather stations right here. One is ours. Lori did this for me. And so I think this is the one that is, this weather station that's like, looks like a snowflake, was owned by a particular grower that we have in tree fruit. And he purchased that years ago. He has another orchard that's about 4 miles away. It has a totally different microclimate than the one he has right here. So his daughter, which is like a really wonderful thing, she is able to go on the NIWA. And so I think when Chris was talking about NIWA, or mesonet and mesonet, we call it NIWA. And that's the Suffolk County pronunciation of NIWA. So NIWA, they are able to go on the NIWA web network and able to see what's happening as far as the wind speed, what's happening as far as climate on that side of the highway. And instead of it taking her 20, 25, up to maybe 40 minutes to go from 4 miles because of the kind of traffic that we have in the summertime. She doesn't know whether or not she's going to be able to spray. So she grows on the network. She finds out what the wind temperature or what the wind is on the other side of the highway. And so she can make her decision without traveling that far to figure out what she's going to be doing. Another interesting fact this is the next picture. This has just happened August 10th, so it was last week. We had an incredible windstorm and rainstorm. My son works at a winery that right in this area. We live over here. He told me it was the hardest rain he'd ever seen his entire life at the winery. There was sheets of rain pouring. That was, I think, 6 inches of rain was happened right here, and we had none at our house, no rain. And so you can see here the rain was 0.4, you know, it changed to 1.46 there. We've heard just homespun tales of 6 inches of rain, but we're not quite sure exactly how many inches, but that was just one occurrence, and we had a tornado. So as you can see, because we're surrounded by water, we have so many different microclimates, and we could have a hailstorm out here at this particular winery, and then over here, you know, just nothing at all. So those are one of the reasons why that we went ahead, and we were very fortunate to be able to get the grants for this funding. Now, Lori is going to speak to you about the hows and the whys and how these networks all work together and how the growers use them. But before we do that, one of our grant funders, we were able to produce a Vimeo production. And so it'll give you, it's just 6 minutes long, it's very short, and we'll give you then the sort of an overall picture of how this all came together. I think that's the next slide, right? Here we go. Okay. Is that it? Here we go.
Oh, okay. So we should take your mic.
Is that picking up? Farmers are looking.
volume.
Actually directional, so you have to use that part.
I see, thank you.
And it has to be really close.
Just lay this down.
Yeah.
And it'll go like this. All right.
Due to increasing pressures from state regulations on pesticide and nutrient loads to protect our groundwater and the ability for the farmer to maintain a sustainable business, farmers are looking at ways to help them make their job easier and more effective. One way they can do this is with a relatively old technology with a new twist. Becky Wiseman, Cornell Cooperative Extension's Agriculture Stewardship Coordinator, applied for and received grant money from the Long Island Futures Fund, the Long Island Community Foundation, and the New York State Ag and Market Specialty Crop Grant.
First of all, growers in Suffolk County are facing some of the biggest issues that they've ever had to face before. And that is the 21st century challenge of how to grow specialty crops and grow them in a way that is fundamentally sustainable. And it makes it even more complicated because we're growing crops in a maritime climate. We're surrounded by water on all sides. Two crops I focused on this past year, vineyards and tree fruit. Both are require a lot of intensive efforts on management to make sure that a pest doesn't destroy the entire crop. So our strategies are reaching growers through outreach and education, and also to install weather stations. This is probably one of the biggest achievements that we've been able to accomplish in this grant. Before this, there were only two weather stations on Long Island that were connected with the NOAA website with Cornell University. And now we have over 12 weather stations here on the island. And why this is so important to us is that there are very unique weather pockets or climates here on the island. What's happening at, say, Watermill is not the same kind of climate or weather patterns that are happening in Suffolk Town.
So we've installed these weather stations in the vineyards as a tool to provide pest forecasts for the growers. And these forecasts can help them better control the problems that they have in their vineyards, whether that be insects or disease, too much humidity, or whatever the problem may be. This is something that can help them control those problems.
So working with tree fruit growers in both apple and peach production, we're now have the ability to integrate weather stations into our program. These weather stations are absolutely great because they help us calculate the in-field high and low temperature, leaf wetness, precipitation, wind speed, which all relate to the grower's everyday management practices. High and low temperatures help the grower determine growing degree days, which enable you to pretty accurately guesstimate when a pest is actually going to emerge in your orchard. They've been doing studies on these all over the countries for years, and they're able to say oriental fruit moth appear on such and such a growing degree day using a certain base calculation. So the grower is able to take a look at the weather that they got from their weather station, come up with these numbers, and accurately spray instead of by chance, by calendar, by I feel like they're here. So it gives you more accurate applications. The leaf wetness helps a lot with disease prevention. It lets growers know when plants are most susceptible to disease outbreaks. It helps them time everything a little bit better. The wind speed on these is invaluable to knowing when is it proper time to go out and spray and when is it not. With a day like today, it's high winds. A grower can actually go to the station. It's above my 5 mile an hour per limit speed restriction, so I can't go out and spray on a day like this. It's too windy. So it gives them kind of a more accurate, instead of just their historical knowledge, their gut feeling, it gives them some kind of concrete evidence to go on.
One of the big advantages with this system is that we don't need to come out to the field to check the data. We don't need to come to a manual rain gauge and measure what's in there. Everything is processed digitally and sent to the IP100, which then uploads to the rainwise.net server. So all of the information that is coming out of this weather station is available online with a couple clicks of the mouse, which saves us and saves the growers a lot of time from coming out into the field to check the data, and also enables us to have data that is continuous, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days of the year.
And what we've been able to achieve through the course of this grant is truly, truly the cutting edge of modern agriculture. And we're being able to demonstrate that it is possible for our growers in specialty crops to be able to grow a sustainable crop in our maritime environment.
If you want to access the information from the weather stations, you can go to www.newa.cornell.edu.
Okay, how's that working? Yes, got the advancer, okay. So that was our cute little video. Our grants help us develop that. It's on our website, check out Vimeo's. We got a few others out there. But just quickly, I just wanna tell you guys who's using this information. Most of the times on the website, you'll see it's geared towards tree, fruit, and viticulture. Long Island, we have a ton of different commodities, and a lot of them are taking advantage of it in the non-generated, non-traditional ways. I have nursery guys using it, the viticulture, the tree fruit, sod guys are using it, vegetable producers, and actually even landscapers are using this information nowadays. And I'll get into that a little bit more in a second. This is one of my growers. This is Tom Wickham. He has a great historical orchard. It's been around now for about 10 generations. It's right on Peconic Bay. So he's affected by water like you wouldn't believe. He was actually flooded out during Irene, lost a bunch of trees. He's actually finding all of a sudden diseases are a big issue because of the weather changes. So this is actually a fire blight in his. This was the first time he's seen it since he's been growing, and he's been growing for 40 years. So we're able to actually calculate changes in his personal climate, changes in humidity levels, changes in moisture levels that are all leading to diseases. And he has the weather station on site, so we're actually now able to monitor him a little bit better and get his fungicide practices up. This is the grower Becky was talking about. There are two different stations. This is the Atlantic Ocean on the bottom. This is Mecox Bay. You got a bunch of little creeks in here and everything, and they totally affect the weather. I cheated, these weren't from the same day. But you can see it actually was very foggy down at Mecox Bay. At the site, it wasn't that foggy, but it's totally different weather conditions, and it's only like 2.5-3 miles away. So it's one of those things as to, oh my God, okay, I have to go spray. Get my car, go out there, drive, see what the weather is doing, drive all the way back, load the sprayer up, half an hour trip with the sprayer back to it. Oh my God, it's 20 mile an hour wind gust. I can't do anything. So she's now actually able just to walk into her office, check out everything online. These two I actually didn't cheat with. I took the readings at the exact same time. You have 4 mile an hour winds at the farm stand. At the home farm, it's 11. So there is a big difference with these little microclimates. And a lot of it's because the water. The water temp is different than the air. It kind of plays with the wind temps. So a lot of growers are just kind of using this as a quick cheat to treat multiple sites because they're not all located in one section. They're typically a farmer, then 5 miles down the road is another plot. Also, housing is another big issue for us. We have a lot of farms that have gotten surrounded by housing developments. This particular one used to have a nice, really sized farm. She's now at the end of a cul-de-sac. Her neighbors aren't a big fan when she goes out and sprays. So she's actually constantly checking NEWA from 2 in the morning till about 6. to see when the wind has died down and she can actually go out and spray the orchard and not have all the neighbors in an uproar, because that happens almost weekly with her. So she's another one. She's using it not for its intended purpose, she's using it for an additional benefit. So she's also using models, but it's a nice little bonus for her. Rainfall, as we said, rainfall varies so differently. You guys get it up here with the hills and the valleys and the mountains. It's 10 miles down the road, there is what storm. So this enables the growers to see exactly what's going on when we have stations located all down the road. They know, oh, you got really lucky today. You got rain. I didn't. And exactly how much. And it's nice, we do use the RainWise site and actually gives us 15-minute updates, so the guys know immediately. Then they'll check out the NEWA site at the end of the day. The next one is the NEWA site for modeling. It's absolutely wonderful for our growers. They're using it. I'm actually using it a lot for pest prediction dates, because instead of hand doing all of my growing degree days for, in this particular case, apple maggot, it does it for me. Saves me a lot of time, a lot of calculation errors, because a lot of things can go wrong very quickly. So this way, we're actually putting out the traps when they're needed. We're not out there 6 weeks early hoping that we're going to get something. It saves me time and money. It saves the growers time and money. Connolly moth is another pest we're dealing with, and you guys all deal with it if you grow apples out here. Connolly moth, we're using a lot of pheromone disruption ties, so these actual models will help us determine when the ties are going to go out, so we're not out there and we're not getting the end of season life, because those ties are only 6 months. So if we're all of a sudden putting them out a month early, well, what happens? You're going to have to go and spray, so it's kind of a wash and you didn't need to do it anyway. We have degrees days. This is what our nursery guys are actually using it for, nurseries and landscapers. They're using all these degree day calculation models for all their other pests. Most pests out there have degree days, and they're actually just taking advantage of this free information. And because they run their landscaping companies all over the East End, they're actually able to get numbers from where their customers are, not where they're located, which actually does save a lot of people. We're actually taking it a step further. We're taking the degree days formulas and we're kind of comparing them to the trap counts for bugs that really don't have degree days. So we're kind of taking it a step further and trying to figure out what this issue is. And these guys, if anybody's never seen these, are leopard moths. They're kind of cute little moths. They hang out in trees. All of a sudden, they like our apple producers down there. So we're trying to figure these guys out now. Okay. Do I have a minute or two left, or? Okay, it's just two slides. So essentially, problems we faced. If these were easy, I think everybody would have one. We've come up with a few issues. Our biggest issue with the NEWA stations is finding a great location that is somewhere in the field, but you need that internet access. Oh great, we have internet access in the stand, but the siding is not friendly to the IP100s. So we have to play around with everything. They're great to have, they're great info. We also found out an issue is you can't put them somewhere where somebody's gonna accidentally back into them or hit them with the boom on the combines. So hence this grower, we decided to put it on a light fixture on the outside of his parking lot. So you're not getting any heat, but it was the only site available for him. So it was, have to go fix it. It's a whole day project. We also have insects that love our stations. They always kind of find a little way in. I don't know if anybody else has birds living in their rain bucket, because that's a ready built-in nest kind of a thing. And we also, our maritime climate is wonderful for rust because we have so much salt in the air. So we have parts rust out, the motherboards rust out. We also have a few stations have lightning issues. We have a lot of lightning storms, heavy lightning storms. There's something about the lightning in the air that just likes to knock these stations out. So those are some of the problems that we faced. And check us out. We have Facebook. We're on, we have web pages. We have Vimeos going on. So I'll answer any questions during the discussion.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. Thank you, guys.